Welcome everyone to our actually second meeting of our German area group TinyML. So kind of we are planning to have these meetups more often. I will tell a little bit more about it. What we have planned today is that we actually have at the beginning we have a talk which is given by Raphael Stahl, and we'll talk a little bit about the research at TU Munich. How to move net inference to the extreme edge. And then afterwards, I think what we are kind of having to, trying to have is a little bit of interaction, a little bit of networking. And yeah, let's just see how this works out today. This is by TinyML. So this is a kind of international foundation. So there are a lot of groups around the world. So they're the biggest one, I think, is on the West Coast in the US. And from there, we have a lot of kind of sponsors who are kind of supporting the activities. So we have a Deep Light, then a company called Kitso, Edge Impulse, Reality AI, Maxim Integrated, and SynthSense. So thanks for them for supporting this. And as you can see here, we have two other talks coming up. So take this as some information for future talks. Okay. First, I want to introduce you to now this German committee. So we kind of formed this group a few months ago. Actually, this was done by Carlos. He got the took up the initiative. So Carlos, maybe you want to introduce yourself a little bit first.
Hello, everyone. This is Carlos Hernandez Vaquero. I'm a software project manager at Bosch, developing IoT devices in the Stuttgart area. And yes, we just started this, so I hope many people in Germany join us to continue further. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Carlos. And we have a second organizer, Alexis. He can't be here today, but he's also kind of supporting this activity. And I'm Daniel, so I'm having here from also Technical University of Munich. I'm usually doing electronic system level design at the chair of electronic design automation. And at the moment, I'm also a professor as an interim head for the chair of real-time computer systems. And the idea kind of, and also why we have this meeting today, is our goal is to bring together a little bit also the activities on TinyML in Germany, right? So I think these meetups are really a great opportunity to share insights, activities, get in touch with each other, and kind of see kind of what activities are happening in Germany. And as you can see, for example, also just from the company names here, I think Germany is very strong, actually, for example, in sensors. And of course, this TinyML offers a very great opportunity, for example, to do some processing near the sensors at the extreme edge. And we are hoping that this forum here really then becomes kind of also some kind of activity which can kick off some interesting collaborations, offers you some opportunities for networking and so on. Okay, great. So afterwards, so we would now for today, we would have the talk from Raphael, and then afterwards we would have kind of a Q&A on this talk that we can ask questions directly on this talk. And then what we're kind of planning to do is that you have kind of a little bit of a networking. So if you're interested, you can stay in the call. People might be interested to introduce themselves to here to the group and talk a little bit about why they are interested on TinyML. And hopefully then we get some interesting discussions going on. Okay, good. So let's start with the talk. So Raphael, he's actually in my group here at Technical University of Munich. Where he also studied his bachelor and master. And before he joined my group, he was at the Fraunhofer Institute of Embedded Systems, where he kind of worked on reverse engineering for software. And at the moment, he's targeting neural network inference some target-aware methods to actually reduce the memory footprint on the embedded software. And he already received a Best Paper Award on some TinyML work at CIPT 2019. Okay, great. So then I would hand over to you, Raphael, and please go on and give your talk.
Yeah, thank you very much for the introduction, Daniel. Welcome everyone also from my side. And I will give you an insight of what is happening currently at the TUM, or more specifically our chair of electronic design automation, how we are trying to move neural network inference to the extreme edge. So first of all, quickly clear the title up. The edge devices here are prominent for being limited in their resources, especially computation power and memory. And they are faced with lots of data because they are on the edge of the network. So they really interact with the real world, gathering data through cameras, microphones, etc. And then neural networks play an important role in this field because they are the state-of-the-art solutions for many nonlinear problems. They are especially useful in this context because they transform the incoming data into some more reasonable size or format, and maybe even enable a local decision right on the device. So this would reduce the communication demand with other devices, reduce latency of the application itself, maybe higher availability if you don't have to interact with other servers. And privacy concerns are also addressed because you don't move data of other people around. So some examples of applications I'm giving here. So one is audio, where you talk into some microphone, and that one detects maybe a few keywords to then wake up a larger device. So that is displayed down here. It's really the embedded device cannot yet do complex tasks, so it is faced with a simple task, which is still difficult algorithmically, but easy with a neural network. Then vision task, very classically the image recognition, or also, for example, video wake up, where a network detects, is there a face or is there no face? Again, to wake up and trigger a more complex mechanism. There's also radar. I think this is interesting lately for many automotive people, where you do some gesture in your car and accelerometers and stuff. And these can all be implemented in small devices. Today I wanna go into two topics here that we are addressing currently. First of all, our chair has around 20 researchers, and four themselves are and supported by about 5 students all the time, are solely responsible for this TinyML topics. The two things we are working on, the first one is mostly finished, was the deeper things, where we do distributed inference of convolutional neural networks. This was in collaboration with University of Texas in Austin. And the second topic I'm going to address is our TierFlight microcompiler, which does a static code generation for models. And this was with an individual, Christoph Petig, and help from Infineon. And we are involved in the publicly funded projects that are compact and scale for edge displayed on. So I'm starting with the deeper things work. First of all, what is this distributed inference? The problem is that you have some memory and compute constrained devices. Like these can also be larger class devices, not only microcontrollers, but also mobile phones or more powerful embedded devices. And the issue is that they sometimes, or depending on the application, cannot possibly store the complete CNN because it just would be too large in terms of memory. And sometimes you cannot avoid, or you do not want to use the cloud backend because either privacy or latency and availability issues. And so the goal of this work is that we kind of combine the resources of all these devices in order to enable or be able to run such a network in a collaborated, a distributed effort. And the scenario is kind of that the devices stay idle most of the time, so that it makes sense that they cooperate, because if they would all the time be busy with work, then this scenario doesn't make much sense. And we introduce also methods to reduce the communication demand that is introduced, because I mean you cannot avoid communicating if you distribute such a task. So I'm going to first introduce the structure of such a convolutional neural network. So this is the typical structure, what you will often see for these final networks. So it starts with some input image in this case. This can also be audio data formatted as an image, where you have some channels, colors, or frequencies. And then you apply these convolutional filters, like a bunch of filters, in this case 8 filters, that run through a convolution of the complete image and produce feature maps. And often in the first part of such a network, this is very feature dominated. So with that I mean that these feature maps make up the most of the memory requirement. But then later, the number of filters increases because you want to extract more complex features and really let the network do its magic. And so at one point, such a network turns really weight dominated, that you use up a lot of memory for the weights. So there are two issues we have to solve. So what DeeperThings does, it starts with the initial networks and then distributes this into smaller parts in terms of features and weights to distribute them on different devices. So for features, we introduced the method fused tile partitioning. This is some existing work that we built on. And this will kind of combine the RAM resources. And then on the weight dominated side, we apply this optimized weight partitioning, which combines the ROM resources or splits up the data across the devices. So the flow of this method is that we take the initial network, then we first have to decide where is this point where when we want to switch. This is not obvious, so we build an optimization algorithm based on integer linear programming to find the optimum where we want to switch to globally reduce the memory requirement per device. And then on the feature dominated partial CNN that results from that, we apply the FTP method to get our shares of the network. And on the weight dominated partial CNN, we apply this OWP with different methods to split the data that I will go into detail right now. And then we also get the weight partitioned networks. And these are then obviously applied to the devices. So we'll first start with the feature partitioning of the convolutional layers. So these are the feature dominated ones. So we want to partition by the features. So this is the fused tile partitioning, where we essentially split the input feature maps by in a grid. We split it in a grid form. Because the convolution operations kind of have a certain locality. So if you produce the convolution outputs of this corner of the image, you always get results in this corner of the output feature map. And then we can continue with this set of data to go through the next layer. So you kind of stay localized, and then we can avoid communication between layers. So we can continuously run the whole stack of data until the end, and then split these tasks across to the devices. There's a tiny trade-off here, and it's more complicated than displayed here, but I will not go into detail on this right now. So the majority of our work was then concentrated on the weight side. So if we have weight dominated layers, so here we use this optimized weight partitioning. And to explain this in more detail, I will first start with fully connected layers because they are a bit simpler to follow through. Here we have a simple fully connected layer displayed where we start with four input neurons and end with four output neurons. The process of this operation is basically we apply a summed weighting of the inputs and then an activation function. So we notice right away this is very weight dominated because we have input times output number of weights. So here I'm changing the visualization a bit to make it easier to follow. So now in this bottom line, I'm introducing an example where we start with four input neurons. So this is represented by the arrow. And then the operation itself that contains kind of these weights is in the box. So we go from four input neurons to eight output neurons. So this layer one operation contains 4 × 8, 32 weights. And this example just is four layers in sequence. And so we result in this example with the number of weights to 240. So what is a naive way to process or distribute this example network? So the simplest is pipelining or sequential layer mapping, where we map these different layers onto different devices. So here in this example, we put layer one and layer two on device one, and device two gets layer three and layer four. So the issue with this is that the major issue is that we don't really get balanced partitioning of the weights. Because it's very difficult to find partitions that match exactly and have the same amount of weights. So here, for example, 160 and 80. And you can only move these in a certain way because you don't want to move the data back and forth. So for example, if we have layer two and layer four on device two, we have unnecessary communication. And if you don't have, or if we have our scenario, the idle workload, that we don't really get any parallelization. That's also an issue. So what are ways to achieve this balanced partitioning? So if you look again at this fully connected layer, we kind of want to split the weights evenly. So we introduced this layer output partitioning where we only in one partition, we only produce a subset of the output neurons, which will result in only using a subset of the weights. So here we start with all the input neurons in one partition, but only use half the weights to produce half the outputs. And the same in the other partitions, or if you have more partitions, you split in more ways. And then of course, you have to follow up with some concatenation operation where you put the values back together into some vector. So applied to our example again, this is a bit more complex down here, but in principle, we transform the layer one into two partitions, layer one, partition one, layer one, partition two. And then we do this concatenation on both devices because this will reduce the communication demand a bit because we don't only have to share these half values and not the full values afterwards. So the goal is achieved with this in that we split the weights by exactly the number of devices. So here we get 120 per device, but we also get a bit more communication demand. So if we add up these red arrows that cross the devices, we land with 34. Let's look at another way here. Here we can split the weights by the inputs. So we named this layer input partitioning. You only use a subset of the inputs and subset of the weights to produce some outputs. But here we notice a small issue that the output values will not be finalized. Because if we look at the C11, we don't have the, all the input values, so this will not really be a final weighted sum. And we first have to combine the results of all these partitions in order to apply our sum and then the activation function. Maybe to note here, this activation function is nonlinear very often, so we cannot apply it, for example, before and then continue onwards. We have to wait for the sum. This is required. So the main idea here was that we can combine these two approaches also. So if we first apply this layer output partitioning and then the layer input partitioning, so first we take all the inputs, have our subset of the outputs, and then we continue with these further to produce our partial output values, then we can kind of combine two layers without any synchronization between these two. But then again, because of this problem with the nonlinearity, we really have to synchronize afterwards, because now we need the sum to apply the activation function, and only then we get the final results of the second layer. So now if we apply this to the example again, here in a naive way, we combine layer one and two and layer three and layer four. We achieve again the perfect splitting of weights across the devices, but you can notice an issue that this increases communication demand by quite a bit, because we first have to move all the results back to this merging process and then send it back again for the second fused operation. And this is kind of unfortunate in this example, of course, constructed to show that, because in the between layer two and layer three, we have a lot of data to communicate. So this is just to show that it's important where you apply this fusing, because you might also make the communication demand worse. You can, for example, in this particular example, apply this LOP method for layer one and layer four instead, and only fuse layer three and layer two and layer three to hide this 16 values as internal pass through. So this goes from layer two to layer three in a fused operation. So we don't have this very large exchange of data and can hide it with a fusing operation. We also expanded this method to convolutional layers, which are weight dominated. I will just briefly go through it. It's maybe difficult with the limited time. We take some input feature maps and then only apply a subset of filters, which will then produce some layers of this output. So some feature maps of this output. So here it's kind of a layer of values that we can compute with these filters. And then we can switch the dimension of our filter bank and use exactly this layer of weight values to produce the partial outputs of the second layer. Again, these will be partial values, and we will have to sum them up with the other partitions in order to apply the activation function again. So here also, after two layers, we have to synchronize. So we evaluated this method with these four models. To the right is shown this YOLO V2 model, which does object detection. This was tested on a cluster of Raspberry Pi 3 embedded devices. And we could show that we really divide the memory requirement by the number of devices. So if we use two devices, we about split the memory requirements. And by applying this optimized weight partitioning, which chooses between the layer output partitioning, layer input partitioning, and fusing, we could reduce the communication demand over a simple LOP split by 28.8%. And of course, the scaling is very dependent on the communication speed. So if you have fast connections, we get faster with more devices overall, and with slower connection, we get slower overall. but always the OWP is faster. Okay, so I will move to the second topic here, which is the TensorFlow Lite microcompiler that we developed. So the main motivation overall for these activities that ended up in this tool is that we see a large overhead of these tiny ML libraries, and the peak buffer sizes limit memory quite a bit. We want to work on that. And then the network architecture search and network optimization we see right now are not really tailored to target hardware. So this is kind of what we are trying to tackle overall at our chair at the moment. And this first point, then in more detail, is this TensorFlow Lite for microcontrollers. It's a library by TensorFlow that is targeted at microcontrollers. But the approach kind of has some overhead. So this overhead of using such an interpreter that takes in an existing model and processes it online is not ideal. And it takes this opaque buffer like a finalized model, and then this is very critical for safety verification processes. And the scheduling and allocation always happens on the device. And we want to avoid that and move that off device. So the existing flow is, there is some model that is created in TensorFlow. And then you can use a tool called the TF-Lite Converter. This is not related to TF-Lite Micro, but TF-Lite is such an kind of an intermediate layer for mobile devices. And then you get this flat buffer, which can include quantization, for example, that's done by the converter. And this is then moved onto the device, which interprets this file and then does this execution planning, the allocation, and then uses the TensorFlow micro operations, like optimized kernel operations to run them on the device. So instead, the compiler takes this TF-Lite file offline and processes it to then generate some C++ code that directly executes this model. Of course, we lose this dynamic way of using any file, but now we lose all the overhead of this interpreter and just have code that calls directly into these TF-Lite micro kernels, like the operations. This uses just a generator approach to write out code. There is no more trace of the interpreter and a lot of code that follows along with it. We write concrete typed buffers. So this is important if you want to do some kind of functional safety verification. And all the scheduling and allocation happens offline, and we could have arbitrarily complex scheduling and allocation implemented there. This started kind of as a parallel effort of Christoph Petig and Asset Tum, and we have decided to merge these projects to take the best sides of both. And this is now released as open source under the given link. And we have submitted a design document to the TensorFlow group for this micro library. And are happy for any, if we have any comments on that. So simple preliminary results right now is we take a simple multi-layer fully connected network, deploy or compile this for some RISC-V target, and we see that we can reduce the ROM usage by almost half in such a simple model. So these are really tiny models here. This is a few kilobytes, and also some RAM savings. Of course, this is very much dependent also on the model. And in this simple example, it doesn't do much computation. We lose the computation overhead of the interpreter, and we see that quite significantly. So to give you a few more outlook things that we are doing at our chair. We will be looking at the network architecture search, especially target aware, to build a better model. And then we want to improve on the pruning and optimization of this network, quantization, to produce a better optimized model, and then apply methods such as weight packing, memory planning, like things that we can already do offline, then feed this to the compiler to produce more efficient static code, and then also use like target-specific operators. And we are looking especially at the RISC-V architecture and see what we can do there. And this is our GitHub link where we will publish our open source software. So to summarize, I presented today the deeper things method where we distribute a convolutional neural network. This achieves balanced partitioning, so we get even memory usage on every device, and we optimized for memory usage globally and communication demands that arise. Then I presented the TensorFlow Lite microcompiler, which generates a static model code to run directly on the target without any interpretation. And this obviously then reduces the memory and computation overhead and increases the transparency for verification. Okay, thank you very much for your attention. And I'm open for any questions.
Thank you, Raphael, very much for a nice talk. Okay, Raphael, so I would give you the first question from Daniel. And he's asking, which protocol do you use for communication between the devices?
So this is right now using a simple handwritten protocol. So this is nothing fancy right now and no standard. It's just using sockets and some custom format. Mostly we know when we want to send which data. So it's limited to really size and buffer and maybe some control bytes.
Okay, thanks. We have a second question from Markus. Thank you for the great talk. Is there a method to make the distributed inference privacy preserving?
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, because we mentioned privacy as a motivation, but then of course we are sending the data right now completely unprotected. So the privacy motivation was more directed towards an outside network. So the scenario is that you have some local network and then send the data within this network. So these devices would be together on some site in some factory. But I think there may very well be methods to make this privacy connected. You need some method to share keys and then you can encrypt the data, for example.
Okay. Thank you for the answer, Raphael. So we got a new question. What if you have non-homogeneous devices? How do you take in consideration devices' capabilities in the optimization?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we now assume these have the same capabilities, but these methods like the LOP and LIP methods split between the input and output neurons, and you can really make it any share of neurons and therefore also weights. So if you have one device that is double the compute amount than a second device, then you give 2/3 to one device and 1/3 to the other device. We haven't really looked at like the full implementation, how to do this. And of course you would need some method to measure these capabilities and then negotiate like who gets what. But these methods itself are definitely compatible to do this distribution.
Okay. We got Carlos also has a question. I think this is to the second part of your talk, Raphael. So the question is, what are the disadvantages of the TF-Lite microcompiler in comparison to the regular TF-Lite micro? For example, to update a model, I guess in the TF-Lite for micro, the part you update is smaller, so for RF devices which require model updates, this might be a disadvantage.
I'm not sure if I completely understand the question. You're saying the disadvantage of the compiler
I would say it goes in a direction saying, right, in the interpreter approach, you can just change the file, right, and therefore update the model, while here you basically...
Exactly. This is what I mean, Rafael and
yes.
Daniel.
Okay, I see. Yes, definitely. That's a disadvantage. You then have static code that is fixed to the model. So you lose the flexibility of deploying any model. But even then, we noticed that to really make that TierFlight micro interpreter work correctly, you have to give it kind of the layer operations you want to use. So it would be very bad to tell it, I want to use all, because these are really huge. There are many options, and this will increase code size by a lot. And then if you limit yourself to a subset, and then you also are not fully flexible, because you have to change which operators you use anyway at some later point. This is also something to consider here.
Okay, Daniel actually gave a second question. So he's asking, so what's the difference between this compiler versus the TVM micro?
TVM and tools such as Glow, I think, aim in a similar direction. But we right now really try to solve this issue in the TensorFlow ecosystem. So of course, actually, you can achieve more if you have a fully powerful compiler tool like Glow that really goes through the operations and figures out like the flow of data, and then optimally compiles this to some machine code, even not source code like we do now. But this is a simple way how we can use this existing ecosystem of TensorFlow and deploy efficient models on it.
All right. Thank you, Rafael. I think we would still have time if somebody has some question you would like to ask. Also, please just feel free to speak up if you like, or raise this hand sign, then I can give you the mic. Okay, great. Then I think we will also have time later on to have more discussions if you like. Rafael, thank you very, very much for the nice talk. And thank you everybody for dialing in. So to kind of conclude now this official talk part, right, so again, please notice here the sponsors who make this possible. And you actually here at the end of the slide set, you find some more information on them. Right, so there is for each of the sponsors, we have a slide. So we have here DeepLight, who is trying to make AI faster, smaller, and more power efficient. We have the sponsor. Here you can't see it very well, but this is actually a company is called Edge Impulse, and they actually make TinyML for all developers. So they're trying, I think, to facilitate bringing TinyML to the devices. We have Maxim Integrated, which is also trying to enable Edge Intelligence, and Kitso, which is had a tool called AutoML for embedded AI, and finally, Reality AI, which also helps in building TinyML products. And the last one, I think, is Synsense, which also is working like in this field of ultra low power sensing and theories. Okay, there will be kind of some other talks. So the idea is, I think there is something like more local talks. So this here was, for example, a local talk from the German chapter. And as you can see here, for example, there are also more broadly distributed talks, which are then kind of global talks, which are then basically distributed to all the members and all the local meetups. So I think this is actually a very nice system. Right, so you can always get up to date what's also happening in these other groups. And there are really some, let's say, expert talks already available from the people in this field. So here are the next ones coming up on October 13th. Okay, great. So I think this would kind of finish our presentation part. And so thank you everyone for joining. And if you like to kind of get in touch with more people, please stay into the call and then we can have kind of a more open discussion. And otherwise, if you have to drop out, thank you very much for joining. And it was a pleasure to have you here.